Ladies and gentlemen, in one of the rare interviews given to the media by one of my next guests, he said memorably, "I'm not looking to be loved. If I threw a party, it would be in a phone box." I suppose agents, or as the latest regulations want us to call you, intermediaries, do have an image problem. And yet, for example, would you, any one of you, be happy to let teenagers, in so many cases with perhaps potential football talent, but not a lot of knowledge of life, to negotiate their own contracts with some of the clubs and chairmen and CEOs that we have known over the years? In truth, there are good agents and not so good agents. 'Twas ever thus. And some of them make an awful lot of money, yes, for themselves, and a lot of times for their players. But are they value for money? And what is the future of the football agent or intermediary? We have got a terrific panel to discuss these issues. One of them, sitting next to me, negotiated the first £1 million player, sent another to the England manager's job, and began his agent's career with a bloke called Cruyff. Another is American, grew up on baseball and basketball, as Americans are prone to do. And then in 1994 at the World Cup, discovered something called soccer and its players. The other is simply the biggest, owns the Stella Group and represents hundreds of players, including the most expensive of them all, Gareth Bale. And if you're a Manchester United season ticket holder, we'll be asking him when Gareth Bale is coming to Old Trafford. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Dennis Roach, Richard Motzkin, and Jonathan Barnett. Let's be topical. We love being topical. The transfer window has just slammed shut in Europe and most of the world. How do you regard, Dennis, the transfer window?
At this time, not very successful. What's happened with our football association, with FIFA, over the last few months has been, to my mind, a severe disgrace. I think that they are definitely going the wrong way. I was going to, when we've had a couple of lessons, I was just going to read a couple of things here, which are just show that the fact that what it's going to do to football players, agents, etc., I think it's going to be a tremendous damage.
Richard, how do you, on the other side of the pond, regard the transfer window?
You know, I sort of look at it as, it's like anything else, it's evolving, right? So there's different rules and regulations that exist that try to regulate how and when players move. And by way of example, in MLS, we have different transfer windows because the season's different. And so, you know, you need to understand which jurisdictions, what the different transfer windows are. And, you know, and ultimately, I think that, like anything else, they're going to evolve and change. I mean, I always find it somewhat interesting that the season's already starting here in the EPL, but transfers are still ongoing. I think that's disruptive. You see the De Gea situation where...
You might come to that.
Which it seems somewhat mind-boggling from an outsider looking in to see that that situation sort of reached where it did, and I'm sure there's multiple sides to that story. But some form of rules and regulations to deal with the movement of players are important, but it also needs to respect and understand that every jurisdiction has different issues to deal with.
Jonathan, would you continue with transfer windows, or would you open the window 365 days a year?
I think I'd open it 365 days. I think it's just not right. I think clubs should be able to buy and sell players. Players should have the freedom to move when they want. I also think the actual soccer window gives agents a bad name and gives everybody the wrong idea. That I get people phoning me up and saying, "Oh, you must be very busy now." Like the other 3 months, 6 months, 9 months a year, I don't do anything. And I think it's not quite like that at all.
But have you been busy in the past few months?
I'm busy 12 months a year. We look after
players.
So what
are you doing when you aren't buying and selling players in the window?
I'm laying on a beach. No, we run a proper business. You know, it's a business. It has staff, it has clients that we look after. It's a misconception. We look after players. And that is an all-year-round job. You know, and that's what people have to understand. And with all due respects, since agents have come into business, players are properly looked after. You take Jimmy Greaves. I'm pretty sure none of my players will have to make a fund for money for him. And if you look at the 1966 World Cup team, nobody looked after them. And look, most of them had to sell their shirts to survive. Agents look after players. We make no mistake. We do not regret what we do. We look after players, and we look after them all year round, and to make sure that they've got money.
Yeah, and just to amplify on that, you know, I know in the last panel, there was talk about whether somebody would be referred to as an agent. And the truth is, I'm a lawyer by training, and I do refer to myself more often than not as a sports attorney as opposed to a sports agent. But we manage players' careers when we're dealing with the talent representation side. And it's not just when they're playing either. I'm sure most of us here also, you build long-term relationships with your clients, and they become, in many instances, de facto family members and very close personally. And so you're going to end up looking after people that you care about and managing their careers. So during the non-transfer windows, as he indicated, I mean, you're dealing with all the off-the-field issues, whatever those might be in terms of helping set up that individual no different than you would your own children in terms of the reality of life and making sure that they're taking the proper steps, that, you know, their playing career is only so long, and then there's also dealing with what happens post-playing career.
Dennis, how do you observe the job of the agent today as compared to when you started?
Extremely difficult now. I mean, if you can buy, I've got a list here. I was going to read it, but just the worst is the fact that I can have an agent under my contract, right, and somebody can still approach him and make him an offer.
Player,
an offer, and so that means I could be sitting there thinking I've got this player, and somebody will come along with a bit more money and go, "Do you want to come?" And if he's one of those players, who knows? Usually they're nice guys, but if they're tempted, they go and they've gone, and you're left without your, after all the work you've been putting into it, you're left because he's gone off to with a fellow who's got to pay out a bit more money.
So you think it's even more Wild West than it used to be?
Oh, far. What's gone on? I mean, I came to let, I've got two pages, one the good and one the bad. Shove that out to various people if they want, but it is very poor. I mean, things that have been agreed by FIFA and by accepted by the Football Association and the others, it's made it really difficult. I have, with my close friends who I know as good agents, etc., have been talking around, and we're just going to go up and sit there and do the job we've done before and ignore it, because if we try to cooperate with that, it's completely hopeless.
Jonathan, do you think it's more Wild West today than it used to be when you started?
No, I don't think it is, actually, with all due respects. I think when I first started, it was a lot of one-man bands and things. I think today, the companies that control the agency side of and it's throughout the world, there's not that many, are proper well-run companies that actually look after the players, do have a lot more facilities, and obviously have the money to be able to do that.
Yeah, I'm not denying that you have companies and stuff, but people who are trying to be agents or young agents or in Canada are really going to have a hard slog, because it's just going to bounce one to another. And I'm telling you, I've had two already from friends, people phoning me up to say, "Look, what am I going to do? I had this player, and now this fella's come along and offered him this, and he's going." It's not like it used to be, and it's not like it should be.
I think, I mean, I can only speak for my company, and I know Wasserman as well, but we actually don't go around trying to take other people's players. I mean, I think there are a few single people that go and take your players or anybody else's players because they need to earn a living, and they're running around, and they should be taken out of the game. I have no problem with that. But today, I think young players need to have proper organisations that can do everything for them and look after them. And I think it's getting harder for the one-man band. I do understand that, but I also think that that's the correct way to go. It should be with people.
With respect, you're talking about yourself all the time, which is, we know you're one of the best in the country. I've had God knows how many years in being safely put and had a wonderful life from it. But there are genuine agents to now who are being walked on by FIFA and the Football Association because some of the, I've got a list of eight things here which are absolutely atrocious and allow everybody to deal with everybody and pay less money and do this. It's ridiculous.
No, I agree with you. Sorry, I misunderstood you. I agree 100%.
I mean,
the rules
with FIFA. Why don't we hear some of your points?
We'll come to you in a minute.
Let's go. Yeah.
I agree with you with FIFA and all the rules, and I'm sure we'll come on to that.
Yeah,
which I'm very much against.
Sorry.
But I don't. I think between agents, I don't think it's so bad. I think the rules and everything are ridiculous.
Good. Okay, well, let's talk about then new regulations, right? There are new regulations. We'll come to what the situation is in the States, because you, not long ago, almost had a strike of the MLS, and we've got their commissioner here tomorrow morning. It'd be interesting to hear what his take on it is. But in terms of these new regulations, you're not an agent anymore, Jonathan. You're an intermediary.
I can't spell that.
Do you? What? Is it going to change your life?
No, not at all. I think the biggest thing is that, and I've said it before, is that the people who, so-called people who made these rules, which I believe, well, I think we'll come on to it, are completely illegal.
Yeah.
And I think, as you know, we've challenged it in Brussels, and we will challenge it everywhere. I think they don't know what they're talking about. It's as simple as that. One of the things, and I don't know about Wasserman, but I think we are one or two, if not the biggest in the world, certainly one of them. And nobody from FIFA has even bothered to come to any of my offices or had a discussion with me to ask actually what we do for a living. And they've made rules without knowing. They read the headlines and think that our main job is to go out and broker a deal for clubs. And those rules are made for, I don't know who they're made for, but they're not made for football agents because they really don't know what we're doing for a living. And there is no dialogue and they come up with the most ridiculous things.
Yeah.
In your country, how regulated are you?
Well, for agents right now, we're not particularly regulated. I mean, FIFA's sort of punted everything to the national associations, and there is some registration requirements vis-a-vis U.S. soccer in terms of sort of being licensed with U.S. soccer as an agent. Now, as a lawyer, you're sort of exempt from those regulations anyways because you're held to a higher standard. But in terms of what you alluded to earlier, you know, in the American sports system, the players' unions, and the players' unions are very strong, and there's the league. And so what happens in, whether it's MLS or American football or the NBA, there's a collective bargaining agreement that dictates the terms and conditions of the management labor relation. So, and in most of the leagues in the US, there's salary caps. And so there's all sorts of negotiation that goes on in terms of the terms and conditions between players and management. And so what happened at the beginning of this year was the current CBA had expired at the end of last year. And as these things often do, it came down to the wire, but they resolved it.
This is interesting because you're quite used to salary caps, aren't you? And living within them. These gentlemen are not, I suspect.
It's illegal.
Well, it's not illegal if it's collectively bargained for.
Yes,
so it's not illegal in that sense.
But that's not going to happen.
You don't see any legal caps in this country? Any caps in this country that are enforceable?
Nor should there be.
Do you, Dennis, are you in favour of caps on agents' fees?
Yes. Do we like that?
No,
I don't like it. I certainly don't like it. But
I'm not talking about players' caps. As opposed to agent fee caps. Although there are agent fee caps in most of the other sports, but not as low as what they're proposing here. But I guess the analogy of the salary cap and all that would be the financial fair play stuff that they're trying to institute.
But Jonathan, your view is that an agent cap is not only illegal, it's also unenforceable. Is that right?
Yeah, completely.
Because?
It's against the law.
Yeah, but why is it unenforceable?
Because it's not fair. And I think, you know, you have to look at the free trade agreements and by the EU.
But I mean, FIFA are endorsing it.
No, they're not actually. They're it's a proposal.
They're not opposing it.
They're not opposing it,
and neither are people opposing it. And this period of time that's going to go through before something is settled is going to be the worst that we've known, because it's going to be embarrassing. People who are playing football can walk up to somebody and say, I'm an agent. How are you doing? I can do you better than that. You're going to come to me.
Oh, yeah.
Yes, you can.
That's ridiculous.
I mean, it's something which is totally unacceptable. People have got to know that at least from the people who are supposed to be looking after them, Football Association, FIFA, at least looking after the agents' associations who are working to get the players the best they can.
The thing that is the most stupid thing is, and people have to understand, to look after somebody is quite a responsibility. And yes, at the end of the day, when somebody retires in their 30s, hopefully having a great football career, they've got to retire with money, they've got to retire with having all the right things. And it's a big responsibility for an agent. To allow any sort of person to just walk up and say, I can be an agent, when his day job is something completely different, and so in most cases not even successful at what they do in that particular field, I think is outrageous.
No,
but I also think, but again, because the FIFA and everybody else have never really spoken to agents, the exams that they used to run and the qualifications are absolutely stupid. Yeah. I mean, there should be proper training, proper looking after, and all these things have to be implemented.
Knowing that I was going to see you guys this morning, I talked to one of my mates who seeks to enforce some of these regulations.
You've got a mate?
And I said to him, I've got a mate or two. Yeah. More than maybe.
Yeah, you're in a phone book.
Maybe more
you're
than
in
you
a
have in the phone book.
Yes.
No, and I said to him, well, what do you ask them? And he said, what the problem is with these agents, they really, deep down, are fearful of too much competition. Is that right?
Absolutely not. No. I'm not fearful of any competition.
No. I mean, I'll give you an example from my perspective. A few years back, for the first time, the players' union published everybody's salary in MLS. And, you know, at the time, a lot of people said, oh, isn't that terrible for business? And I said, no, not at all. I think, one, the more information, the more openness, the more transparency, I think, one, that'll demonstrate a competitive edge and that we're doing a really good job, better job for our clients than anybody else. And, two, ultimately, I think that kind of information long-term helps the players. And so, you know, and as Jonathan alluded to, I mean, it's a proper business. I mean, if you're going to do something and you're going to do it well and run it professionally, you know, it's a lot of work.
Let's get something that I'm sure our audience would want to know. How did you start as an agent? How do you become an agent?
Well, I was going to let it go for a while and then tell the story.
Yeah, so there you are.
The story, I won't tell the full story because it's a little bit long, but basically I was playing in Barnet Football Club, who were playing in the league. I was captain centre-half for 9 years. Went on holiday, sat down on the beach. I had my wife and my son, and another family came along. And walking down, I looked up and I said, that's Johan Cruyff. Christ, what's Cruyffy doing here? So anyway, he came and sat in the next tent. Cut very quickly, we got on like a house on fire. We were playing with the porters all the way through the holiday. We had a great time. 2 weeks later, when I got home, I had an invite to go over to his home, stay the weekend with him, because they had a film about him and we were invited to go to the film, my wife and I. We went over, and coming back to the house, he said, come down to my basement. Went down the basement and it was packed with beautiful stuff. And I said, what's all this? He said, well, there's people going to be looking after us now. We're going to go into things. And, you know, we've got to get stuff like all the gear and all the stuff sold and done for players. So I said, well, very good. I said, what have you got? And I saw something. And I said, oh, it's nice, and didn't say a word. And then he said, well, look, what I want you to do is be my agent. And I said, what's an agent? And he said, no, seriously, Dennis. No. So I said, well, I've heard about it. And I said, but I said, I'm still playing. He said, well, you know, go ahead, go back to London for 2 weeks and let me know. So I went back to London for 2 weeks. And the first day I got back, I had a phone call from my neighbor who is a lovely guy and was head of a company called Shredded Wheat. You know, Shredded Wheat, Nabisco Shredded Wheat. And he said, you know, I'm going to get sacked. And he was the big man in it. I said, why? He said, we can't get anything to fit in the boxes. So I said, fine. Would you pay half the price for me to fly back to Holland? I said, because I can bring you back something from where I've seen, and it'll work. So he said, do it. So I did it. Went into Cruyff, brought this beautiful box out, which when you opened it, it was Cruyff heading the ball, Cruyff kicking the ball, Cruyff changing the ball, all sorts of beautiful pictures, all lined up, done beautifully and all the rest of it. Took it back over, went to the big party on the Friday, the meeting with the ladder, accepted totally, boom, gone. And I had 22 players that knocking on my, 22 paper people knocking on my door. Wow, what's this? This is not all right.
And most players didn't have agents in those days.
Most players didn't have agents. I didn't know, I hadn't playing, I didn't have an agent. I never knew what an agent was. So he said to me, now you're my agent. And I said, well, okay, I packed up at the end of the year. He invited me to the World Cup. I went with the actual team as the press man.
The Dutch team.
The Dutch team. They played, unfortunately, played the final in Germany and lost, just lost. And then he signed for me and I signed six other players who went off to America, Canada and all that.
Jonathan, how did you, because you were an Arsenal fan.
I hate following that story.
You're an Arsenal fan.
I am.
And then, and how do you become an agent, for goodness sake?
I was working in the entertainment business, and I decided I wanted to change my life in that way, and I was friendly with Imran Khan, who's a cricketer, and he asked me, a bit similar to that, to see if I could help him in some things, which I did do, and he introduced me to Wazim Akram and Waqar Yunus, and I got friendly and started doing some cricket work, and I met my partner, David, and we've been partners now for 25 years. And we decided we would start up, and we had some cricketers, and it was doing okay, but nothing, obviously, in cricket and great. And then we decided to go into football, and we drove up and down motorways trying to sign players.
And how did you, when you say you drove up and down motorways?
We went.
Did you go to training grounds?
No, we just went up through introductions and what we could. And we found after 3 months of going everywhere, we'd signed exactly zero because nobody wanted us. It was simple. And to be honest with you, we had no experience in football. You had football experience. Yeah. I didn't. And I just think I can look after you. And they said, well, who have you got? And we had nobody. So we were trying for bigger players. So I decided with David that we were going to try for the young players. And I think we were the first to do it. And I went up to Chesterfield to watch England versus Spain under 16s play. And England got beaten 5-0. And after the game, the England team were all sitting there, the young boys and their mothers. And I went up to them and introduced myself. And I think that was the only first agent they'd ever met. And I signed. I think 8 out of the 11, and people like Ashley Cole and other people like that, Ledley King, and it just took off from there. And
year was that?
18 months? 18 months ago, yeah. 1990
something. And how many players does Stella represent now?
A few hundred. I don't want to get into exactly.
1994, of course, is the year of the Soccer World Cup in America.
Yeah.
Yep.
And here's this baseball, basketball fan, yes?
Yeah, so my start, I didn't grow up with, as we call it, soccer in the States, football. And, I was just, it sort of started developing a little bit after I was a teenager. And I was a young lawyer, very interested in sports. The law firm that I worked at, we represented some organizations like the Dodgers and Olympic Committee, got in with that group, and then I got an opportunity late 91, early 92 to be the general counsel and run business and legal affairs for US soccer and work on the World Cup. And at the time, it was one of those things where, and I think you'll find this a lot in stories of agents, you have to be flexible and sort of go where the opportunity is.
Yeah.
If somebody had said, oh, you're going to end up being an agent, I would have said, yeah, that I might do that because I love sports. If they had said soccer, I would have said, no chance. I didn't know anything about the sport. But long story short, I moved to Chicago and spent 2.5 years working on everything with the World Cup and the U.S. soccer, from player-related matters, stadium deals, FIFA, federations, an incredible work experience. And when that ended, moved back to LA and basically started my business. And as all of us do, we have families who don't get enough credit and support. My wife was a lawyer at the time. We were recently married, and I started the business by myself out of my apartment, representing a handful of the guys off the 94 World Cup team, like Alexi Lawless and Tab Ramos, and many of these guys who, as I alluded to earlier, it's not just during their playing career, I still represent now and help out, whether they're broadcasters, coaches, et cetera. And then I grew it for 12 years and sold it to Wasserman, and now help run, you know, as Jonathan mentioned, you know, one of the bigger agencies in global football.
Jonathan, you've talked about players. We haven't talked about clubs. And of course, agents represent clubs sometimes.
Yes.
Why do clubs need agents?
I think because we have a better idea of what's going on out in the market. And we probably know the other clubs better than they do. I mean, if you think of two clubs, they probably only talk to them. So if they do a transfer between each other, they hardly know each other in real terms, because they may only do one deal in their whole lives together. We probably know more about what's going on in the market and how to get to the players and how to achieve a proper deal.
And is that argument about when players, a player, an agent is on both sides of the table, is that, how on earth do you justify that?
I don't.
You don't? You think that's wrong?
Yes. I think you either represent the club or you represent the player.
So when it happens, does it still happen?
I would hope not. But I'm sure there are some circumstances that it does. My group don't do that. I'm not saying we're whiter than
mine. I mean, listen, what I would say in that instance is, you know, and again, I think I agree with you. Generally, you represent one side. But I think ultimately, as long as there's, you know, openness and transparency in what's occurring, you're actually doing a service for everybody, right? Because, it might be, in going to the earlier question, you know, why you might be involved on the club side, it might be that you have a player that is not getting playing time somewhere, and you know another club, they'll get playing time, and you know, and so you're helping to facilitate a move that actually benefits everybody.
Yeah.
Do you, Dennis, isn't the truth that you, that the problem with the image, because where we started, the image of agents, is by definition, you clubs always suspect you're destabilizing players, that you, one club players are no good to you because they don't go anywhere.
I don't accept that, because basically if you are an agent and you are working, and you will end up going with certain clubs more than you do with others.
Yep.
And those certain clubs are the ones who trust you and who send you away somewhere on an aeroplane to look at, to check something out and do the rest of it. And you come back and you give them a report and they're happy and they bring the player over and they do it. So they trust the agent. And you get I've had through my life lovely time of being able to go to clubs, be accepted, be laughed at, we have good fun. Then we get down to business and we do business. And it's only if I say a stupid agent, but an agent should know and must know when he goes what his chances are to do a deal with the club. And generally, if you're lucky and you're very, it's a very nice situation. And you know, I've never gone to a club that felt don't appreciate me. I go to clubs where they appreciate me and appreciate me.
When you hear Jonathan, do you want to follow?
Just like to say that we get, if they renegotiate contracts at a club openly, we get paid for the renegotiation.
Yeah.
Openly, so it's not as if we need to transfer the player. It's complete fallacy. We don't need to do that.
Exactly.
And nor would we.
Sometimes, though, you know, some agents have a share in the ownership of clubs, don't they? So again, it's in their interest.
Well, that's third-party ownership.
Yes, and which is what I want to come on to. I mean, where are you on third-party ownership, now outlawed, effectively?
I'm very pro it.
So am I.
Because, first of all, in the in South America, for example, most clubs are completely broke. Yeah. And they couldn't even keep their front doors open if it wasn't for people. And it's not just agents that are involved in third party. I think the biggest owner in South America is a supermarket chain that invests in players. But they do it to obviously make money, but it keeps those clubs going. I promise you, if you take away third party from some of these clubs in Brazil, Argentina, Uruguay, you'll have no league. There's no money there.
Yeah. So it's not slavery?
No more than the rules and regulations are here for a player, where a club can sell a player They've got two contracts. They've got a contract. And in that contract, the player can't suddenly say, I want to leave, and they do it, but the club can.
Yeah.
Is that what difference in that?
Richard? Where are you on third-party ownership?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's hard to have sort of blanket rules for the entire world. I mean, you have to look at the different, you know, as Jonathan said, I mean, you have different realities and different economics and, you know.
What do you mean different realities?
Well, I mean, you know, the TV revenues in the Premier League are vastly different than where they are in the rest of the world, right? And so, you know, I think there needs to be, you know, a respect for contracts, and ultimately if people are bargaining at arm's length, then there's, you know, and there's deals that are negotiated that are clear and understood and respected, then, you know,
I think it's moved above. If you've got the upper divisions and things like that, you'll get very, very rare situations where they've got a manager who is, say, criticising the player and creating problems. Maybe third, fourth division if they're looking to get relegated or something. But there's such a good feeling in football clubs now in England. And they're all very so welcome to be there, and they're so welcome to get there. The problem is getting there. And the only way you get there is by having a good agent who will look for one and bring him to you. And this thing on the what's coming out at the moment, well, will destroy a lot of things because a lot of... let me tell you just something very quickly, right? I've got a house down at Bournemouth. I live on the water. And next door, a fellow was painting the house. And I walked by and said, good morning, Mr. Roach. I said, oh, good morning. He said, I'm with you now. I said, oh, you're with me now? He said, yes. He said, my son, he's 17, and I'm his agent. And I said, aren't you painting? So he said, oh, yeah, I'm painting here, he says, but I'm taking over as his agent and I'm going to find him. Would you be prepared to help me and come and, you know, so-and-so? I said, well, I might find it a bit difficult. I'm busy at the moment. But where did you... this was before I was just finding out a knowledge about what was all this was. And I thought, what the hell's going on? Then I looked into it and I thought, oh.
I shouldn't be concerned then when I hear that Agent X has too much influence at Club Y. Go back to Dennis's point that some agents have good relationships with this club or that club and the other club. That shouldn't be of concern.
Why?
Of no, so. I asked the
no,
question.
No, not at all. Not at all. If you look at, I mean, all the criticism and everything else, football is better than it's ever been.
Ever been.
Everything is wonderful.
But the gap between rich and poor has never been wider.
And so it should be. I mean, it's going to be.
It should be.
Yes. Yeah, you can't bring the playing field level, because if you have Man United playing in front of 80,000 people, they want to see the best players in the world. Right. If you put Hartlepool, with all due respect, in the stadium of Old Trafford...
I haven't got any Hartlepool supporters here.
Yeah, I played there. Yeah.
OK, I sorry. On purpose. Yeah. Nobody's going to turn up to watch it.
Yeah.
And people knock football, but in fact, around the world today, it's thriving. The players are the new superstars, and the business is absolutely thriving in football. And I think a lot has to do with agents making it happen.
Can I ask you about one particular organisation which has been discussed at this conference already, called FIFA?
Who?
How do you, Richard, regard FIFA as and the current travails of FIFA?
I mean, I think we're all sort of waiting to see what happens. I mean, I think it's an organization that's in serious need of reform. I think everybody would agree with that. I also think everybody would agree it's complicated, and how you figure out a way to properly reform it, and who's going to lead that charge, and what it's going to look like. You know, as a governing body for the sport, you know, obviously there's a lot of good that it does in terms of social responsibility and helping fund projects all over the world, and you know, being the ambassador for the sport. But, you know, and then in terms of rules and regulations and making sure the money flows where it's supposed to, I mean, that's a situation that certainly needs to get looked at and cleaned up. In terms of agents, they've sort of punted the rules and regulations that, you know, you used to have to be licensed by
FIFA.
Have
they given up trying to regulate agents?
I don't know if they ever really regulated them, but I think... No.
Have you won, in fact? Because they, if they have given up regulating agents, you've won, haven't you?
I don't think we ever
tried to win. There are rules and regulations laid down by the FA.
Right, yeah. So it's not the National
Which have to be, so there are rules, just maybe they're coming from the FA or from the American Association. Each local association have their own rules, Germany, Italy, France, whatever. It's just that FIFA as a governing body don't have any saying it anymore. Mm-hmm.
And the short answer is I don't think, again, if you're running a business properly, you're not threatened or bothered by proper rules and regulations, right? And so we might agree or disagree what those rules and regulations are, but having some sort of, level of professionalism in the industry is something we would all support.
I think also, everybody, like you say, there has to be rules and regulations for agents, but why? As long as the business itself is run correctly, it comes under the laws of the land and everything else.
You say that, but if somebody can go and speak to your agent, if you would go potty, really potty, if somebody, you found out that the fellow was down in the car sitting outside your place talking to your player because he's another agent and he wants to take him away.
No, I understand.
You're not going to be too pleased about that.
If you've got a contract, it comes under the law of the land anyway. Mm. But well, I'm not saying that. I'm just saying that there should be rules, but I'm more interested in proper training for agents. I think that is the most important thing. The situation with Dennis just mentioned about a guy painting house, that worries me a lot more, that he is now in charge of somebody's financial future and all the things that go with it. And that to me is ridiculous. Those are the sort of things that worry me a lot more.
Let me ask you about your, I'm very conscious of 9 minutes or 10 minutes to go. Right. Are you, let me talk about specific players. There's a bloke called Trevor Francis.
Yes.
When you negotiated the first £1 million transfer, was it the first £1 million transfer?
Yes, it was the first £1 million transfer.
Did you ever dream, was it 1979, I think, of how much players would cost these days?
No. I mean, I was quite happy with what I got, thank you. It was a very good and pleasant man. I mean,
what would Trevor Francis fetch today?
Trevor Francis, he's now probably, what is he, 34 now, 33, 34. Mm. So he would be probably, genuinely, he's not as quick as he was. He's not, so yeah. I think, but what happened then was he went to Nottingham Forest, and we went to Nottingham Forest, and we did the deal with my mate Cluffy, who fortunately I was a good friend with, and he played there, and Cluffy didn't like him. And I'm saying, if I've been to 3 or 4 of the matches, and I'm saying, what do you mean you don't like him? Look, he's just scored 2 goals. Yes, but so-and-so.
Didn't like him as a person or as a player?
As a player. And yet his assistant, who was there alongside
with Taylor. Taylor
was fantastic. And anyway, Cluffy and I had a meal one night, and I just said, look, if you don't like him, I said, I can sell him because I've got a club who wanted to get him when I gave him to you, and they'll sell a bit more money. And he said, do it. So a year later, he was sold again, and that was it.
But today, he might be worth 30. Would he be worth as much as Gareth Bale if he was being sold today?
Yeah, if Trevor Francis was probably certainly one of the best three players in our divisions, and he was he's an exceptional player. Great lad with it, very, very, I say that because I think to be a great player, you've got to be a great lad with your team, with yourself, and not be one of these, people. And he had everything. He would help people, he would see people, and he had a lovely family. He's perfect, right. So he would definitely be.
Your Landon Donovan, who played a couple of times at Everton, but is now back in the States.
He's now retired.
Yes, but he's now back in the States, and he almost voted with his feet and said, ultimately, I want to be back home. Is that right?
Yeah, and it goes to, ultimately, our job is to act in the best interest of our clients, right? And so, a lot of time, again, you get this bad rap that you only care about money and you're self-interested, and the truth is, the vast, vast majority of agents are not like that at all, and they're looking out for the best interest of their player. And in Landon's case, certainly one of, if not the best American players we've ever had, and had 2 successful loan stints. His priority ultimately, as he went through his life, was to help grow MLS and soccer in the country, and also be playing at home in Los Angeles.
Do you ever say to players, well, actually, I don't think you're the right sort of person, right sort of character to play in a foreign country?
You have to know. I mean, it's all, A broad word for all of this is relationships, right? So you need to know, you need to have a relationship not only with obviously the clubs, but with your player and understand what's, you know, important for them and what they want out of life. And certainly everybody's different, you know, your children are different, you know, and so you need to understand, you know, in a deep and meaningful way, what's going to motivate an individual and where they're going to have the best chance of success. And so, you know, I've also heard, you know, I think the line, you know, the players and agents sort of end up, who you end up representing and who your agent is, ultimately, I think those things are also happen in a way because I think the fit's there and that there is a kindred spirit. And so
what I'm really saying is if you thought that player X was worth so much by getting him a role in a Spanish club, but actually deep down you thought he'll find living in foreign capital X.
Yeah, I mean, listen, it's not like we don't have our opinions and we share those privately with the individual. And, you know, any of us who do what we do, we're very competitive. Mm-hmm. And so by that point, you want to see your clients go to the highest level and succeed at the highest level. So, but yeah, I mean, there's certainly times where you understand some guys will have a better chance of success in a certain place than in other places because you know what they're, you know what they're made of and what they're motivated by.
Okay, Jonathan, as promised, when is Gareth Bale coming to Manchester United?
Next Thursday.
that's an exclusive. How is the situation outside of the transfer window? Has he come anywhere near being transferred in the past few months?
No, not at all. It's all stupid paper talk.
Yeah. In the transfer window.
Obviously, and even out of it. Yeah. He's very happy that at Real Madrid, and hopefully he'll stay the rest of his career at Real Madrid.
Do you think the most expensive player for a bit yet? Or do you think that'll be overtaken?
Yeah, in the foreseeable future, I think he will be. But it's interesting. I think, obviously, you've got Ronaldo, who's probably getting towards the end of his career, and Messi as well. They probably, obviously, that in Spain, they have clauses that they can come out, so you know roughly the sort of values that you have to pay. So at the moment, he probably is the most valuable. It would be a while before somebody breaks it. He's loving it there, and things are going well for him.
He only did it to beat my £1 million one, which was
89 million.
Of course, there was a transfer that didn't go through as well last week, involving the Manchester United goalkeeper. How do clubs like Real Madrid and Manchester United not complete a transfer? How does that happen?
It's just a complete mess up.
Total disgrace.
It's a mess up. I just think. I mean, that's outrageous. It upsets. I mean,
you believe that's.
I do. I don't think it's any Machiavellian plot. I really don't. I just think somebody's made a stupid mistake.
Yeah.
And the thing is, it's the boy, the player that suffers.
Yeah.
And I think, you know, I don't know who's to blame, but it's certainly not the player.
Final question for each of you. If in 2040, Soccerex is here in Manchester and they're debating agents, the super agents, they'll call it.
Yes.
How will the role of your successors, when we're all under the daisies, how will that role have changed, if at all, from today?
For me, I don't think at all, because my son's going to be the agent and he'll look after it very well.
He'll have learned everything from his dad.
From his dad.
Richard?
Well, I'll start with, I'll have a party that's in a much bigger place than a phone booth. So,
you hope.
Yeah, I hope. And, you know, I think at its core and its essence, it's not going to change. I think, you know, it's still going to be about the relationship, but I do believe, you know, it's, you know, we live in a world with much less privacy, with a much more shorter attention span. People are going to really need to, you know, things are just going to continue to move quicker and quicker, and you're going to be able to, you're going to, you know, and the world's getting smaller, so you're going to have to really, I think, understand a lot of what's going on. And I think, you know, the other thing, I think by that point in time, I mean, you know, some of the leagues, you know, MLS, football in America, is going to be one of the top three soccer countries in the world.
So,
for sure, sooner.
I think it's going to change a lot. I think when I first started, the basic contracts that were very basic, and as time's gone on now, with the players have become more superstars, they've become more global,
and they replaced the pop stars of this world. And you know, you got Ronaldo's or Messi's and hopefully Gareth hitting huge numbers. And their marketing is bigger than even the basketball players or the American footballers today, and which is quite a change. And people have to, and that's one of the things about the painter and all that, people within our organisations are going to have to be much more much more educated to be able to do contracts. The digital world is coming in, they've got to understand that. So it's going to be a proper, I think much less and less of the one-man bands and much more of organisations that can actually negotiate proper contracts, understand the marketing much better and the digital world much better. And I think that's going to be...
So I would agree with you on everything except the one-man band, because I still feel somebody like you, somebody like us, if you like, there has to be at some stage somebody who's...
They can't handle it anymore. They really can't. It's getting so big. And it's no just...
You know, I mean, we were talking about this earlier. So, I mean, the athlete is a brand now, right? And so you've got the athlete marketing piece, the social media piece.
That's right.
Are you going to ban your players from using social media? Isn't that a...
Well, shouldn't you educate them?
No. We have people that look after their social media now.
As well.
As well, so they don't do it. They hardly do it themselves.
We could talk for a long time. I'm very conscious that we're out of time. Back in this room at 2 o'clock for the evolution of the stadium experience, or perhaps you'd like to join me at 1:45 in the Academy room with Tony Adams and Kelly Smith fighting their demons. Sounds intriguing. Hope you'll join me. Thank you very much to our panel.